Good morning, everybody. If I could please have your attention. The family has requested a special song, so I would just ask you at this time to please silence your cell phones. If you should need a restroom, it is through the center doors of the church and to the right. And obviously, with all of the news about the variant, if you are more comfortable in leaving a mask on through the mass, we ask you to do so. But if you are fully vaccinated, it is not required. At this time, I'm going to play an instrumental piece for the family, so I would just ask that you just join us in reflecting on the celebration of Stephen.
Got credit card debt? Find a New Balance transfer card at Credit Karma. When you transfer your...
Thank you.
Good morning again, and thank you again for joining Stephen's family to celebrate his life. If you did not hear earlier, the restrooms are through the center doors and to the right, if you should need. At communion, Father will explain how communion is done. And if you are more comfortable in leaving a mask on during Mass, we invite you to do so. But if you are fully vaccinated, it is not needed. At this time, we ask you to stand.
The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. Come dance in the forest, come play in the field, and sing, sing to the glory of the Lord. Praise for the sun, the bringer of day. He carries the light of the Lord in his rays. The moon and the stars will light up the way unto your throne. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. Come dance in the forest, come play in the field, and sing, sing to the glory of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
As our brother Stephen died with the Lord, so may he live with him in glory. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Father.
My name is Father Bill Coffis. I'm the pastor of our Mother of Sorrows and Holy Cross parishes. And on behalf of our entire parish family, I would like to welcome each and every one of you to this celebration of the Eucharist, in which we pray for our brother Stephen in thanksgiving for his life and the way he has helped us on our journey of faith through his example. In a special way, I welcome Father Wieland, Father Manera, to this Mass. It's wonderful, fathers, to have you both here. I really hope that each and every one of you, through this Eucharist, encounter the presence of our loving God, that through the prayer that we lift up to Almighty God, we may be reminded of how close our God is, especially in our time of need. I really hope that you make yourself feel at home. And in that spirit, I invite you now to be seated as we listen to words of remembrance.
At this time, I would like to invite Stephen's nephew, Jeremy, and best friend, Scott, forward to share a few words about Stephen. Okay, Jeremy. Okay, it's okay. Jeremy will cover it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Don't worry, Scott will be speaking later today. A slightly inappropriate thought just crossed my mind as I was walking up. For some of you non-Catholics here today, the bowing that you see up front, I assure you it's not bowing to his photograph. And he did not tell us to do that, so I'm guessing that may have crossed some of your minds. For those of you who I've never met, my name is Jeremy Frank, and I am Stephen's nephew. I want to start with some thank yous. I want to thank everyone for being here today with us, especially those who have traveled from afar. Can everyone hear me? I'd also like to thank everyone for bearing with us these past 10 months. The whole world has faced unprecedented challenges, and planning this day was certainly challenging. We're still dealing with challenges today. So thank you for your patience and understanding while we navigated COVID-19. I'd like to thank those of you who wanted to see Steve in his last days but couldn't because of COVID. We know that, and we know that was difficult, and we know your thoughts were with him. And finally, I'd like to thank those of you who were there in his final days. You know who you are, and I was fortunate to be there, and I describe it to people as the worst experience of my life, but also one of the best. We were able to keep him at his home that he loved, to keep him comfortable, surround him with love and peace. It really was perfect. And if any of you have been impatient waiting for this day to come, I assure you no one has been more impatient than Uncle Steve himself. I know he's with us in spirit today, probably in the back somewhere, maybe relaxing with a glass of Chardonnay, watching every detail unfold, hopefully to his approval. Like many of you, I see reminders of him everywhere, and I feel his presence and hear his voice. I heard his voice this morning. He said, "Jeremy, this is a big day. It's been 10 months. It is time for you people to get together, to celebrate my life, to say nice things about me. And since you've had 10 months to prepare, this eulogy better be perfect." Perfection was important to Uncle Steve. I think most of you here know that. He always tried to put his best foot forward, took a great deal of pride in his appearance, great deal of pride, and he enjoyed helping others achieve their best. He had very high standards and a unique way of letting others know when their efforts didn't quite measure up. If you didn't know this about him, I would invite you to just ask any restaurant server or bartender at one of his favorite Boston establishments. They will tell you there may even be written documentation. He developed an appreciation for quality and perfection at a very early age. In one of the last conversations he and I had, he asked me out of the blue what my earliest childhood memory was. I told him, and then he shared his. It was of a family trip to Boston. When he was 4 or 5 years old, his parents and sisters took a trip from Rochester and walked into a restaurant. He thinks it was Anthony's Pier 4. He vividly recalled several details: the mahogany bar, the oversized leather chairs, the lighting, the music. This is a 5-year-old, by the way. It was clear to him that no detail was overlooked, and that those responsible took great pride in the presentation and the experience there. Young Stephen took note. Most of us are well aware of his affinity for quality experiences and have reaped the benefits whenever we were his guest. Quick story, about a week before he passed, I was with him, and he was learning that some people were going to be coming to visit him, people who had never seen his home before. He's in bed. He really shouldn't have been out of bed much. But when he heard this news, he jumped out of bed, tried to jump out of bed. I stopped him. He felt the need to clean his whole house. I calmed him down, explained that was pretty crazy and that those people wouldn't care at all what his house looked like. That's not why they were coming. So I finally got him back into bed, calmed him down a little bit, laid next to him for a moment, and then he said, "Well, you ready? Because you're going to be cleaning the house then." Let's get started. He loved creating quality experiences that people would never forget. When guests would arrive at his home, appetizers and favorite drinks were always waiting. The house was spotless. The music, the lighting were perfect. Sometimes warm chocolate chip cookies would appear on his guests' pillows at bedtime. I'm told that on the many cruises he took with various friends over the years, he would always host the pre-dinner cocktail parties in his cabin, and much of it would resemble the arrival parties at his home. Beautiful, delicious appetizers, plenty of wine, music, everything would be, you guessed it, perfect. Being the best he could be, helping others be their best, spending quality time with quality people, all while having fun, creating joy, and making people laugh. That was Steve. He had this unbelievable ability to connect with people. I'll ask you to bear with me. And most of you know this. I remember one story that highlights this perfectly. It's a funny story. First time he met my mother-in-law, they spent an hour together, maybe an hour. It was at a group gathering, an hour. The second time she saw him, a few months later, I saw her arrive, and I went to hug her, and I hear her shout, "There's my favorite guy!" Thought she was talking to me for a second. She pretty much knocked me out of her way to go give Uncle Steve a big hug and kiss. And as I was getting up off the floor, I thought to myself, this defines him. This is a perfect example of what he can do for people in a very short period of time. He'd often meet strangers at restaurants and bars, and they'd quickly become friends. Some of those friends have become long-standing friends. The best example I can provide of that is a young couple who got married on Nantucket. When Steve happened to be there with some of his friends, he met this couple, the group met this couple, just a few days after their wedding, became friends. That couple is here with us today. While Uncle Steve would want this speech to be perfect, he knows it won't be the best eulogy it's ever been given, and the reason is simple. Uncle Steve and I already did that eulogy about 3.5 years ago. Many of you were here. Some of you are in the same seats. I stood here and gave a eulogy for Steve's father, my grandfather, Tony Mantelli. Since that day, many of you have complimented me on the job I did, and I'm always quick to point out I didn't do it alone. Uncle Steve helped me tremendously. We created it together. We worked hard on that speech as a labor of love for a person who Uncle Steve described as the greatest man we will ever know. I found that quote in an email Uncle Steve sent me shortly after Tony's funeral. More recently, someone found a printed email from Tony to Steve, and it shed some light on the way Steve's father felt about him. And ironically, the subject line was, "The greatest son in the whole wide world." I'd like to share some of it with you now. This is a printed email from Tony to Steve. "Hi, Stephen. Just thought I would jot down some thoughts that were going through my mind a while ago, that go through my mind very often, and decided to let you know what they are. I was thinking about how much joy you brought into my life. How easy you made it for me to bring you up, and I wanted to thank you for it. And to thank you for working so hard in school, and even harder in the business world to achieve such high levels." Excuse me. "For calling me late at night when you were out to let me know that you were all right. For all the too numerous gifts to mention, like two lawnmowers that start so dependably. For a fantastic trip to Las Vegas, which was never in my life's plans. For a World Series game at Fenway I will never forget. For some very beautiful, comfortable furniture. For the most fantastic B&G oysters on the half shell, for displaying my artwork in your beautiful home, albeit just when I come to Boston," and on and on. This is still Tony's Tony's voice. I can't tell you how proud I am of you, Stephen. Thank you. Love, Dad. P.S. I'm sure, knowing how you are, that you will think of some things I've forgotten. So go ahead, lay it on me. I can handle it. Uncle Steve also helped Tony sometimes with computer and technology issues. I know this, and those of you who knew Tony will appreciate this. This is a printed email, and at the bottom there's a handwritten note from Tony that says, "Stephen, I emailed this to you last night. I received the user unknown reply. Any explanations?" So apparently he printed this and mailed it off to Boston. Closing, many people I know are sad not only by Uncle Steve's passing, but that they didn't know how sick he was. Many people did not know how sick he was. He didn't want people to know. He never wanted to bring people down. He didn't know how to ask for help. He didn't want to be a burden. He was the host. He wanted to serve others. He was hospitality. He was fun. He was laughter. He was Boston. He was joy. He was Steve. And finally, many of you have asked, why? Why him? Why now? Why so young? None of us have these answers, certainly not me. But I thought I'd share some of the thoughts I've had to help me struggle with these questions. I believe we will see him again, and I believe he's in a wonderful place. And it's much bigger than Boston, so it's going to take him a long time to find all the best restaurants and bars and best ways to get around. But he'll do it. And when we get there, he'll connect us with everyone he's met. Chances are, he's already one of their favorite guys. One of their favorite guys. He'll have the appetizers and the wine all ready. It will be perfect. Love you, Uncle Steve.
Let us pray. May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, and may the soul of Stephen, your servant, be welcomed into eternal joy. For as you were pleased to create him in your own image and adopt him as your own, so command, we pray, that he may have a share in your inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you to be seated now for the Liturgy of the Word.
Hey.
At this time, I would like to invite family friends Kevin and Karen to proclaim our readings.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. But the just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. For the age that is honorable comes not with the passing of time, nor can it be measured in terms of years. Rather, understanding is a crown for men, an unsullied life. He who pleased God was loved. He who lived among sinners was transported. Snatched away, lest wickedness pervert his mind or deceit beguile his soul. Having become perfect in a short while, he reached the fullness of a long career. For his soul was pleasing to the Lord. But the just live forever, and in the Lord is their reward. And the thought of them is with the Most High. Therefore, they will receive the splendid crown. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures, he gives me repose. Beside restful waters, he leads me. He refreshes my soul. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Guide me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Only goodness and kindness follow me the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want.
A reading from 2 Timothy. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead? And in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For I am being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My dear friends, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now that very day, the first day of the week, two of the disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those who were with them, who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised, and he has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
The first reading from the Book of Wisdom reminds us of how the soul is pleasing to the Lord. How his soul was pleasing to the Lord. This reminds us that a life of faith, a life dedicated to sharing the gift of love, God's love, a life celebrated with meaning and dedication to others, is a life pleasing to the Lord. Our brother Stephen lived such a life. He has given us a beautiful example of how to live our lives in service to God and in service to our brothers and sisters. He has shared with you his ability to bring joy, his ability to make you laugh, his example of being generous. And we have to ask, where did our brother Stephen get this? Well, no doubt it began here in Charlotte, as he was baptized most likely at this baptismal font near Father Wieland. On the day of Stephen's baptism, as water was poured over Stephen's forehead, original sin was washed away, and he was made a child of God. And he was clothed in the dignity of a baptized believer, a member of God's royal family. and he was placed in a sacred relationship with the Holy Spirit. And one of the surest signs of the Holy Spirit is the presence of joy. And so I would suggest that as we remember those moments from Stephen's life, those joyful moments, we think of them as encounters with the gift of God's presence. It was here in this parish of Holy Cross, surrounded by his parish family, but most especially by his family, in which he continued to grow and to learn about the ways of God. And his faith, Stephen's faith in the Lord Jesus, was no doubt the support, the foundation of a life of love and a life of service. And all of you have accompanied him on this journey, guided by the gifts that God had given to you and to Stephen. He had, and will always have, a special love for family and friends. I heard it said that at a recent memorial that I attended, that when somebody close to us dies, it's not as if we learn to live without their love, but rather we strive to share the love that they gave us with others. And each of you, whether family, friends, colleagues, have been blessed by God through the love of our brother Stephen. Every day, he lived to the fullest, and he shared with so many people, more people than we will ever know, the gift of God's love. Where did he get this from? Remembering that faith was the driving force behind Stephen's life. The faith that was cultivated here, he referred back to that faith and relied on that gift of faith in the Lord Jesus to guide him throughout his journeys. So whether it be practicing his faith, coming to Mass here in this beautiful church of Holy Cross, or at any place that he would pray, or at any place that he would attend the Mass in his travels, and at the beautiful Cathedral Church of Holy Cross in Boston, our brother Stephen sought to encounter the presence of our loving God through prayer. And it was through the listening of the Scriptures, the reception of Holy Communion, the greeting of the kiss of peace, and the sending forth into the world that guided our brother Stephen to continue on in his journey, to continue on sharing the gift of God's love with others, bringing joy, calling people to their best selves, and no doubt it was Stephen's faith in the Lord Jesus that guided him even in those most difficult days as he dealt with illness. The gospel that I selected, taken from the Gospel of Luke, is the longest account of an encounter with the risen Christ. We hear in this gospel that Deacon Joe proclaimed for us the account of two of the friends, the disciples of the Lord. They have witnessed the Lord suffering death, and now they're hearing stories of resurrection, and it's become too much for them. They're confused. And no doubt they are asking questions. Why him? Why the one we love? Why, when he was in the prime of his life, why did God take him? And as they ask these questions along the way, a mysterious traveler walks with them. And there must have been something familiar about him, maybe his voice or the way he walked, that compelled these two disciples to invite this mysterious traveler to join them at table. And it is a round table, that they realize that this is no mysterious traveler at all, but it is the one that they love, their friend and their Lord in his risen form. And they came to know him in the breaking of the bread. This is very important for us, because I think we ask those same questions that the disciples asked, those two discouraged followers on the way to Emmaus. Why our friend Stephen? Why in the prime of his life? Why him? And even in the midst of those questions, to realize that throughout his journey, our brother Stephen encountered the presence of the risen Christ, who guided him, who encouraged him on the way, who received him in the breaking of the bread, as he would receive our Lord in Holy Communion. It was a round table that many of you have those memories of our brother Stephen in his home, maybe on a cruise, or in one of the beautiful restaurants, either here in Rochester or in Boston. It was a round table that you experienced the love and the hospitality of our brother Stephen. And now, it is around this table from which our brother Stephen himself received the gift of God's presence in Holy Communion, that we are encouraged, that we are helped to continue on our journey and to find the presence of the Lord on the way. Our Lord walks with us. He encourages us. He calls us to deeper faith. And many times, we're not even aware of it until after, just like the disciples in this gospel passage. It is only when we think back that we realize, wow, God was with me in that moment. And so, my brothers and sisters, I invite you to take time today and in the days and weeks and months ahead to reflect back on how God has come to you through the life of our brother Stephen, through this most challenging year and a half, almost 2 years, that we have dealt with the pandemic, and to treasure those moments as opportunities to celebrate the presence of God. Why do I encourage you to do that? Because that is certainly what our brother Stephen did throughout his life. Throughout his life, throughout his illness, he relied on that presence of the Holy Spirit dwelling in him. And that same loving God who guided our brother Stephen into the eternal feast will guide us on our journey of faith. And so we pray for our brother Stephen. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Friends, I invite you to stand as we bring our prayers before our loving God.
For Stephen, who was given the promise of eternal life in baptism, may the Lord give him communion with the saints forever. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who loved and were loved by Stephen, that you may find comfort in your belief in the Lord's promise of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For each of you with whom Stephen so generously shared his many gifts, may you too grow in the ability to share your gifts and lighten the burdens of others. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Unlike our friend and brother Stephen, with those beautiful blue eyes and the 20/20 vision, I need glasses. For all who have died in the hope of rising again, especially Stephen, his parents, Kay and Tony, his grandparents, Frank and Katie, his aunt, Kay and Uncle Chuck, as well as other family members who have gone before him, welcome them, Lord, into the light of your presence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Stephen's family, especially his Aunt Rosie, his siblings Molly and Mary Lou, brother-in-law Gary, his nieces and nephews Kelly, Alicia, Katie, Jeremy, Danny, Jake, and Josh. For all of us, as well as his extended family of great nieces and nephews, cousins, and dear friends, that we feel the healing power of Christ in the midst of our sadness and grief, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
I'm back again, Steve. For each of us present here today, that God will bless us richly with the gifts he knows we need to fully celebrate life and recognize the new beginning which he offers us each day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pause and make our own private petitions in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
And for all those who are considering serving the Lord and the church, through the sacrament of holy orders, holy matrimony, and the consecrated life within the Church. We pray to the Lord. Loving and gracious God, we know that you hear all the prayers that we, your Church, bring before you. As we voice these prayers, we also humbly ask for the intercession of our Mother of Sorrows, who stood at the holy cross of her Son. We implore Mother Mary's intercession as we all pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. I invite you to be seated as we prepare the altar for the Eucharist.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand.
Let us bring this water and wine. May we come to share God's
grace. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the good. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Mercifully receive, we pray, O Lord, the offerings we trustingly present for the soul of your servant Stephen, that through this sacrifice which you ordained as the one true remedy for all, you may grant him everlasting salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
I invite you to kneel or be seated as is your custom. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, our Mother of Sorrows, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Stephen, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Salvatore, our Bishop, and Matthew, our Bishop Emeritus, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant Stephen, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
In a safe way now, let us offer to one another a sign of Christ's peace.
For communion this morning, we invite you to come up to the center aisle to receive Holy Communion. I do ask, please, that you receive Holy Communion in your hand, step to the side, and then in the presence of the communion minister, please place the host in your mouth, and then return to your pew using the two side aisles. If you would like to come up and not receive Holy Communion, I invite you, please, just to place your arms like this, and you will receive a blessing. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Renewed by the nourishment of this sacred gift, we pray, O Lord, that our brother Stephen, freed from the bonds of death, may rejoice to have a share in the resurrection of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you to be seated for a brief moment, please, as we listen to words of sending forth by Stephen's friend, Carrie Lynch.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So about 24 years ago, the president of the bank came into a meeting and said, hey, listen, we've got a new guy joining our team. His name is Steve Mantelli, and he's moving down from Albany. And listen, he's coming to town by himself, so please be nice to him. So I thought to myself, who would move from Albany by themselves to a new town where he didn't know anyone and leave all his family and friends? And then I met you people and I totally got it. But sure enough, a couple weeks later, himself showed up when we were at the table. We're introducing ourselves and I said, hello, my name's Kerry Lynch, welcome. And I looked at him, and he smiled at me, and he said, hi, Kerry, thank you. My life has never been the same. It changed forever that day. Who could turn the world on with his smile? Who could take a nothing day and suddenly make it all seem worthwhile? It was you, boy, and you should know it. With each glance and every little movement, you showed us love was all around. No need to fake it. You could have this town. Why don't you take it? You're gonna make it after all. Love was all around. No need to fake it. You could have this town. Why don't you take it? You're gonna make it after all. And boy, did he ever.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Adventus, so ship me on my tears.
lasting rest.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Stephen, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed upon Stephen in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This funeral mass is ended. Let us go out to love and serve the Lord by serving one another.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Molly has asked me to share the song with all of you. You heard the instrumental before Mass. These are the words.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember, and I did not know no pain, when I believed in forever, and everything would stay the same. Now my heart feel like December, when somebody say your name, cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day, yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. Everything gon' be alright, gonna raise a glass and say, hey. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. Memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember, when I never felt so lost, and I felt all of the hatred was too powerful to stop. Now my heart feel like an ember, and it's lighting up the dark. I'll carry these torches for ya, and you know I never drop. Yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday. Everything gon' be alright. Gonna raise a glass and say, hey. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but tonight, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. Memories bring back your.